We are finishing the book of 1 Corinthians this morning. We're in chapter 16. We're going to pick up in verse 13. We're now at the end of an incredible epistle. Paul is writing this epistle to a culture that had punted when it comes to any moral fiber. It's kind of review, because I think it's important to the close of this to kind of remember the perspective and what had happened up until this point as we're going through the book of 1 Corinthians and concluding the book this morning. Now, remember, Corinth was a place of great commerce. It was a place where two harbors had come together. And because of it, people from all over the globe would stop in Corinth. It was multicultural. It was every nationality under the sun would find themselves. It was the melting pot of their day there in Corinth. And not only was that the case, but it was a place of great wealth, and it was a place of great indulgence. The term to live like a Corinthian was common. It was a phrase that was well known. And what it meant is that you lived in luxury and you lived in immorality. To live like a Corinthian. That was their reputation. To live in luxury and to live in vile immorality. There in Corinth was the temple of Aphrodite, known by the Romans as Venus. And it was in that temple, it was a Greek goddess that they would worship. It was a goddess of love and beauty. And inside that temple, the way they would worship is they hired 1,000 prostitutes. And you would go to that temple and you would gratify your sexual desires as part of your worship to the god of Venus. That was the mentality of the city. This is what was going on there in Corinth. And so It was a church that had been influenced by Greek mythology and every vileness that went with it. And the problem was, the church was now being influenced by that culture. The church was now becoming like Corinth. Rather than changing Corinth, they were being changed. And that's why Paul writes this letter. He founded the church about 2 to 3 years prior to this. They had gotten saved. They had given their life to Jesus Christ. Their life had been changed. And then after 2 to 3 years, they were slowly but surely taking in all of the influences of Corinth into the church body. And so Paul is writing this epistle to correct them. And he's going to define for them what Christianity should look like in a culture that's broken. And he did that as we were going through this book. It blew my mind because, remember what Paul, we're going to do a little kind of quick review this morning as we're closing up the book. I want you to open up your Bibles to chapter 1 of 1 Corinthians. Look at verse 10. He gives us the purpose and why he wrote the book. Look what he says. Chapter 1, verse 10. I plead with you, brethren, by the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing, that there be no divisions among you, that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. What was going on in Corinth? Everyone had their own opinion of everything. So everyone was living differently. Everyone was living however they pleased. And he's saying, look, I want you guys to be of one mind. I want you to have one judgment. I want you to be, speaking the same thing. And in reality, guys, that should be what Christianity looks like. Because we all come under one authority, that's Jesus Christ. He gave us his word that we're to judge everything by, not by our opinions or by what the world tells us, but we're to judge all of it according to what God declares. That's Christianity. And so when Paul is writing this epistle, he's saying, look, this is my goal. I want to take all of this craziness that's going on in the church, and I want to bring us all under one umbrella, under one mind, under one heart, under one direction. He would tell them in chapter 2, the only way that's going to happen, look at verse 6. Chapter 2, verse 6, watch what he says. However, we speak wisdom among those who are mature, yet not the wisdom of this age, nor the rulers of this age who are coming to nothing. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the ages for our glory. And here's what he's declaring. Guys, if we're gonna know anything about God, then you need the wisdom that God provides. You can't conclude the right things without God declaring them, without God giving them to us. And he says, we don't need the world's wisdom, we need God's wisdom. The world's wisdom is forever changing. God's wisdom is constant. It doesn't waver, it doesn't kind of, you know, go this way and then go that way, depending on the tide. It tells us, look, this is what truth is. And it says this kind of wisdom doesn't come from this world, it comes from God. And so you and I, Christian, have a clarity when it comes to what right and wrong is, the Word of God. The Word of God declares to us what truth is. And so you and I come and we say, okay, what does God say on any subject? And you can find that subject based upon the Word of God. And it's God's wisdom, not man's wisdom. Now, he's going to also tell them in chapter 3. Watch, look at chapter 3, verse 1. And I, brethren, could not speak to you as to spiritual people, but as to carnal people, as to babes in Christ. I fed you with milk and not with solid food, for until now you are not able to receive it. Watch this. And even now you're still not able. And here's what Paul's telling them. He says, you guys haven't matured in your Christian walk. You're still carnal. Now, there's a time when you become a Christian and, you know, you just kind of, you're trying to figure things out. You're kind of growing in your faith. And just like a baby, you know, you really don't know. You don't know how to walk yet. You don't know. You don't even know how to crawl yet. And that's normal. That's acceptable. But these Christians have been for 2 to 3 years walking with the Lord. And Paul expected them by this point to have some more maturity and being able to eat meat, not just be given milk. And the problem was they were carnal. Now, that's a term that you know, we use today because of what Paul said here. A carnal Christian is someone who's letting his flesh dictate his life rather than truth and God's Spirit to dictate his life. A carnal Christian means that his own appetites, his own desires, his own flesh is what determines how he's going to live his life rather than what God says determining how he's going to live his life. And so we look around in our culture today and we find even inside the church a lot of people who are very carnal. They choose their own desires over God's truth. And in doing so, you kind of come to decisions in life and you go, you know what, this is what I know I should be doing, but my flesh wants to do this instead, and so I'll choose my flesh rather than what God says. That's a carnal Christian. They're choosing to, hey, I would rather party than do what God declares. I'd rather, you know, gratify my flesh. I like to go to Vegas rather than to go to a conference. You know, those are the kind of decisions a carnal Christian will make in his life because the spiritual things has no priority in his life. The carnality, the flesh dictates his life. And Paul very clearly says, look, you guys should be mature by now, but you're not mature by now. You're still a bunch of babies spiritually. And he just you know, lays it out. And you know, one of the cool things is he says, look, you as a Christian, your life should be changed. Watch, I want you to turn to chapter 6 now. Look at chapter 9. I mean, chapter 6, verse 9. Chapter 6, verse 9. Watch this. Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Who's he talking to? He's talking to Christians. He says, do you not know the unrighteous aren't going to heaven? Don't no one lie to you. Don't let no one deceive you. Watch this. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor rivalers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. But then notice what he says. And such were some of you, but you were washed and you were sanctified. And you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God.
And here's what Paul is declaring to the church in Corinth. If you're a Christian, your life will be changed. And if there's no change in your life, you've been a Christian for, 6 months, a year, 2 years, 4 years, 5 years, and there hasn't been a change in your life, then something's wrong. You're being deceived. Because when the Spirit of God comes into a person, that's called being born again. And when you're born again, you now have been given spiritual life. And as you mature in that spiritual life, you're going to become more and more, transformed in your life, more and more spiritual and less cardinal. And Paul very clearly says, look, you know what? You used to be that way, but that's not who you are now. You used to be a fornicator, an adulterer, a homosexual, a drunkard. And he lays down that whole list. He goes, look, but you've been washed from that. You've been cleansed from that. And your life is now being transformed. And understand something, Christian. If that's not happening and you think you're a Christian, man, I would sit down and evaluate, man, am I really walking with the Lord? That's what Paul's telling them. He's really laying out with them, look, a changed life has to be changed. If you've been washed, then you can't continue living like a heathen. Very clear. That's what you used to be, but it's not what you continue to be, because God's come into your life and he's transformed you. And then he would tell them in chapter 8, look at this, chapter 8, verse 9. Watch this. But beware, what's that warning? Beware that somehow this liberty of yours becomes a stumbling block to those who are weak. What was happening in Corinth is they're saying, hey, well, you know what? I'm saved. I'm free to do whatever I want to do, and I can live my life however I want to live my life. I have certain freedoms. And he says, you know what? Here's the problem, man. Those freedoms have become now a stumbling block for your brother. And because you're causing your brother to stumble, you're going to be held accountable for your brother. And he's telling them, here's the deal, guys. And I think it's something that really struck me as I was studying this close and this passage. It's Christianity should be seen by the way we live our lives. Christianity should be seen, and you're showing parents, your children, what Christianity looks like if you call yourself a Christian. You're showing your neighbors what Christianity looks like by the way you live your life, your friends, your mom, your dad, your brothers, your sisters. You're showing them Christianity. But if they see you compromising your faith and, disregarding the word of God for your own life, then what kind of Christianity are you declaring to them? You're becoming a stumbling block to your own children. You're becoming a stumbling block to your own friends. So they'll never see Christianity. They'll never see what it's supposed to look like because they're looking at you who claims to be a Christian and you're not willing to live your life as a Christian. And Paul just very says, look, your liberties are stumbling other people rather than what? Than sacrificing your liberty so that you can become a good model of Christianity. And so think about this. By this point, Paul stepped on everybody's toes, right? Just in case I missed you, he'll hit the next chapter. Because he's really wanting to do is to correct this error that was happening in the church of Corinth. They started to go off course. They weren't really living the Christian life. And Paul is writing to them, trying to get them back on course again. He wants them to be what? Those who would exemplify the Christian life and the Christian faith by the way they were living. And it should be, guys, we're in a culture that's polluted right now, isn't it? I don't think anyone here would deny that. We're in a culture that needs to see Christianity lived out. And Paul is writing to them saying, look, guys, in order for you to live the Christian life, man, you have to be willing, to surrender your own flesh, to deny your flesh. Now, isn't that what Jesus said? He says, if you want to follow me, pick up your cross and follow me. If you want to be my disciple, pick up your cross and follow me. For everyone who wants to save his life will lose it, and he who loses his life for my sake will find it. That's Christianity. And Jesus, was wanting us to understand, when you think, well, pick up your cross, what does that mean? That means that you die to your own flesh. That's what that's the whole picture of the cross. How many of us walk around, we got a little cross on our, that's an instrument of death. It'd be like walking around with a little electric chair. Can you imagine? Look at my little electric chair. Isn't it cute? Like, what? Are you crazy? No, that's what the picture of the cross is supposed to be. That I've died to my own will, my own want, my own flesh, my own desires. And now I'm living my life, what? For God. For his kingdom. For his purposes. I use his truth as a standard for my life. And so he lays that out. And then he reminds him in chapter 12. Remember that incredible chapter? 12, 13, and 14, we covered it. We took our time through it. It talked about what? The power of the Holy Spirit and the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And he says, look, in chapter 12, look at verse 1. We'll just touch it. Watch what he says. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. That a spiritual person has been given spiritual gifts and we're to be using those spiritual gifts for the furtherance of the kingdom. You can't do spiritual things in the flesh. You have to have the Spirit of God and the gifts that God dispenses to his church in order for you to be used by God. And so he says, I don't want you to be ignorant. I don't want you to be deceived here. I don't want you to be a baby when it comes to the spiritual gifts. And he takes chapter 12, 13, and 14 to explain the spiritual gifts and how necessary they were. And then in chapter 13, we remember that chapter, right? An incredible chapter, because he says, look, man, all of this is done because of what? Because of love. Love. Love's the key. Matter of fact, look at verse 1 of chapter 13. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but I have not love, I have become sounding brass and a clanging cymbal. He goes, you can speak in tongues, you can speak the most beautiful languages, you can do all of that, but if love isn't the motivation and love isn't the preeminent thing in it, he says, it's just a bunch of noise. That's pretty heavy. Just noise. You can act spiritual all you want, but it's just noise unless it's out of love. He says, and look at verse 2, and though I have the gift of prophecy, and I understand all the mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I can remove mountains, but have not love, watch this, I am nothing. Nothing. Can you imagine having that kind of faith you can move mountains? And he says, it doesn't mean anything if love isn't the motivation behind it, if it's not the source of it all. And so he reminded the Corinthian church, look, here's what it's all about. And now he's closing the book. It's chapter 16. And it's as though Paul is writing his last words of encouragement. He wanted them. He goes, now we've set everything in order now. It's kind of like something that was broken. You know, you got a broken bone, and then it comes and gets reset again. That's the picture. And he's going, look, now that we got things set again, now that you know what, you know, where all of these issues stand and where we should be standing on those issues, and then notice what he says in verse 13. And we're going to read to the end of the chapter, and we'll come back. Watch what he says. Watch. Stand fast in the faith. Be brave. Be strong. Let all that you do be done with love. And I urge you, brethren, you know the household of Stephanas, that it was the first fruits of Achaia, and that they have devoted themselves to the ministry of the saints, that you also submit to such, and to everyone who works and labors with us. I am glad about the coming of Stephanas, Fortunatus, and Achaicus. For what was lacking on your part, they supplied. For they refreshed my mind and yours. Therefore, acknowledge such men. The churches of Asia greet you. Aquila and Priscilla greet you heartily in the Lord with the church that is in their house. And all the brethren greet you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. I never read that before. From now on, at the front door. No. We'll come back to that. Verse 21. The salutation with my own hand, Paul's. If anyone does not love the Lord Jesus Christ, let him be accursed. O Lord, come. The grace of our Lord Jesus be with you. My love be with you all in Christ Jesus. Amen. Paul's closing exhortation and encouragement
to the church of Corinth. And it's interesting that he would begin that closing with simply saying, watch. Watch. Watch is, the word is Gregorio. Gregorio is the Greek word. But here's what's important, the definition of that word. This is what it means. To give strict attention to something. To be cautious and to be actively cautious. To take heed lest through remission and indolence some destructive calamity suddenly overtakes one. And his encouragement was, look, keep your eyes open, church. Be awake. Don't fall asleep at the wheel. And that's really the encouragement here. He wanted the church to understand that, you know what, you have to be watching. But why? Because it just takes, you know, something very subtle to begin to get us on the wrong trajectory in our life. Something very subtle for us to all of a sudden we're going down a path that was, you know, a wrong path. And so he told the church, watch, be vigilant, you know, looking around, making sure you're aware of what's going on around you. Over and over in the scriptures, we're told to be watching. Jesus would tell us in Mark chapter 13 and verse 35, he says, watch therefore, for you do not know when the master of the house is coming, in the evening, at midnight, at the crowing of the rooster, or in the morning, lest coming suddenly he finds you sleeping. And what I say to you, I say to all, watch. That was Jesus. He said, you don't know when he's coming back. None of us do. And we need to be vigilant, looking for, waiting for, aware of, you know, that any moment he can come back. Guys, we're living in crazy times. You realize that? You've been watching the news? Just this week, in Iraq, our embassy was attacked. They tried to besiege it. We were able to hold it off. We sent troops in. And then a few days later, on Thursday, one of their planners on the attacks was blown up. I mean, him and several of his friends, Iranians. The Iranians were planning, or the ones who plotted the attack on our embassy, but they're also plotting the attack of other leaders in the country. Our people, the Americans. And so our president made a call. They blew this guy up, and he was kind of the strategy guy, is what everything I'm reading and understanding. And so thinking that we get rid of the strategy guy, we kind of prevent some of the other things that are going to go down. And he did it. And so now we're on high alert right now because the Iranians are saying they're going to retaliate and they're going to try to bomb something. So some are even at the point they're saying this is going to be the spark of World War III. I don't know that the case, but I tell you what, I want to be ready. I want to be ready at any moment. You know, we don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. No one knows. And that's why Jesus is telling his disciples, look, watch. It could come at midnight. It can come at the second watch, third watch. You know, no one knows. But are you ready for his coming? We're told in the book of Acts, Paul was warning the church in the book of Acts chapter 20. It was the first pastor's conference that ever got held. It was in Ephesus. They actually had to ask the elders of Ephesus to come and to meet Paul as he wanted to share with them his last words of encouragement to them. And here's what he said in Acts chapter 20, verse 29. He says, for I know this, that after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. Also among yourselves, men will rise up speaking perverse things to draw away the disciples after themselves. And then he says in verse 31, therefore watch and remember that for 3 years I did not cease to warn everyone night and day with tears. He goes, look, you got to be vigilant, watching, because the enemy is going to try to infiltrate the church. Watch. We need to be people that are watching, aware of what's going on around us. And when Paul is writing this to the church in Corinth, he's telling them, look, you need to be on guard. You need to be aware of what you're surrounding. You need to know what's going on around you. And I think so much so for us, we need to be watching.
We need to be watching at what's going on in our culture. Understand something, guys. The world hates us because of what we stand for. The world, Jesus told us over and over again that the world's going to hate us. In John 15, 19, he said, if you were of the world would love you. Yet because you're not of the world, yet I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. You see, if you're going to live the Christian life, man, you're going to be an oppositional. If the whole world and everyone who's living evil and immoral lives loves you, then something's wrong with you. Seriously. Because you should be different. And you should be living a life that's bringing conviction to the lives of others. And he told us, look, Christian, understand something. We need to be on guard. You need to be on guard. The next word he uses there in verse 13, he says, watch. Then he says, stand fast in the faith. And really what that word means that is that we're to be persistent, that we're to keep one's standing. It's kind of the idea of someone putting their cleats on. You ever tell someone, put your cleats on? Because then you're going to get footing. You're going to dig your feet in. And then, you know, when someone tries to push you down, you're going to have some ground. That you're not going to be moved one way or the other. And really what he's declaring is don't sway when it comes to your beliefs. That's what he's saying. Stand fast in what? In the faith. Stand fast in the faith. Persevere in your convictions. Hold what you know is true. And we're having a whole world that's trying to redefine what true is. That's a culture we're living in right now. We're living in a culture that is trying to redefine biblical marriage. God's the one who designed marriage. God's the one who said it's a husband and a wife. And yet we're watching not just outside the church, we're watching inside the church. I think it was the Methodist church this week. They said there's going to be a huge church split going on in the Methodist church. It just came out. It was just in the news. And you know why they're having a church split? Because they can't agree on the LGBTQTLMNOPQRV group. They can't. I mean, they're split over it. So they one side of it saying, "Look, the Bible says that God. This is how God defines marriage." And the other side of that group saying, "Look, you know, it doesn't matter." And so you have a whole group of people that are losing ground, they're being swayed. They're letting the world define what God says rather than God define what God says. And it's never a good idea when we decide, I'm gonna determine what truth is in spite of what God says. Bad idea. Because you're not standing on the right side. You're standing on the wrong side of God. We have a whole culture right now that's embraced this whole idea that we can just abort our children when we know that God is the giver of life. Jeremiah in the book of Jeremiah chapter 1, he says before I was born you knew me. He says when I was in my mother's womb you formed me. Guys, life begins at conception, according to God. And yet, our whole culture is just wanting to say, look, we can discard of life as long as it doesn't come through the birth canal. And it's sad. It shouldn't be happening in a civilized society that we're killing our children. God forgives, and I understand some of you in this room may have had an abortion, and God loves you. Let me tell you, all he's looking for is for you to run to him. He'll forgive you and cleanse you and wash you. That's not the issue here. But the issue is when we're saying that that's okay and that's normal, then something's wrong. I think history is going to judge us very badly at some point. And I know for sure God is going to judge us very badly when it comes to this issue of life. And just because the culture is telling us this way, and it's sad because, guys, I had someone accuse me, well, you're just a one issue voter because I can't vote for somebody who agrees with aborting a child. You're just a one-issue voter. I said, you know what? If you can't figure out that issue, you shouldn't be answering any other questions. If you can't figure out that issue, that God is the giver of life, then how can I trust you with anything else you're going to decide? And so you can call me a one-issue voter if you want. That's cool. But I believe God is the giver of life. And we can't let this culture declare what right and wrong is, guys. And I think Paul is saying, stand fast in the faith. I believe because Scripture declares that Jesus was born of a virgin, that he was born sinless, that he came into the world to save us from our sin. And the only way to God is through Jesus. Jesus said it very clearly, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes to the Father except through me. Guys, that's biblical truth. Now, you want to kind of water that down or try to change that, good luck. I don't think you're doing yourself a favor, and I don't think you're doing anybody else a favor by doing so. You see, Paul is telling them, don't waver in what truth is. Don't waver in your faith. And he says it very, very, very clearly. Very clearly. And then he says, be brave. That's an interesting word. Be brave. I like how the King James Version says it. There's certain phrases you read in your Bible that only the King James, you know, kind of, in the King James, it reads like this. Watch ye, stand fast in the faith, quit you like men. Isn't that a great? Quit you like men, right? And that's kind of the way that Paul says it in the old King James Version. You know, be brave. You and I, you know, I've been called to what? To be brave. In other words, you're not letting the world bully you into believing or following what they say rather than what God says. I like what Franklin D. Roosevelt says this, courage is not the absence of fear, but rather the assessment that something else is more important than fear. That doesn't mean you're not going to be afraid. When you're the only voice that's, you know, going against the flow. You're the only voice of dissent. Everyone else is in agreement against what God says, and you're the only voice that's saying, you know, that's not true, that's not right, that's not what God says. That takes bravery. That takes courage. And here's the question I've been asking. Guys, if you and I aren't going to be the ones that are brave, what's going to happen to the next generation? If they don't have any model of Christianity, what's going to happen when our kids that have walked away from the Lord come back to the Lord, or God somehow awakens them, and there's no one standing? There's no one that won't waver. No one that'll say, "I'm going to be tough. I'm going to you know, not give in to what the rest of the world is." Because there's going to come a time when people finally awaken, or the conviction of the Holy Spirit is going to come upon them, and they're going to be looking for Christianity. And someone's got to have a mind that's clear enough to give a good example of what it's supposed to look like. And he says, be brave. Be brave. Don't give in. It takes courage. That's why he says in the next word that he uses there, he says, be strong. Be strong. Be brave and be strong. Very much like that word we had looked earlier, stand fast, that word be strong means to keep one standing, to persevere. To keep one standing. Put your cleats on. Don't waver. And you and I are not to allow fear or peer pressure to dictate to us what right and wrong is. Matter of fact, I love what Paul told young Timothy in 2 Timothy 1:7. He says, but God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. We've been called to be those who stay strong in the middle of all of the culture around us crumbling. It's interesting that these terms, all of them, the four that we've looked at, watch, stand fast, be brave, be strong, all of those terms are in the imperative. And what that simply means is this isn't a suggestion. What he's saying is this is a command. It's like a colonel telling his soldiers, this is how we're going to go forward. I like what William Barclay in his commentary, he wrote this. Paul begins with a series of five imperatives. And may we well that the first four have a military background and are like a commander orders to his soldiers. As a sentinel, be ever on the alert. When under attack, stand fast in the faith. Yield not an inch. In time of battle, play a hero's part. Like a well-equipped and well-trained soldier, be strong to fight for your king. And that's what Paul is telling the church in Corinth. Don't waver when it comes to your faith, when it comes to truth. You have to stand strong because our kids are watching. The next generation is watching. And I pray many of them, many kids that I've seen grow up in the church have walked away from the Lord. Guys, we got to stay the course so that when they come back, they find it intact. We have to, because souls are at stake. Eternity is at stake. And he's encouraging this church to do it all with love. It's not like a soldier just start blowing everybody up. He said, you need to do it with love. No, notice what he said there in verse 14. Let all that you do be done with love. Because love's the key. It all has to be as a result of love. Our love for God. Our love for our fellow man. That we stay that course. That we don't waver. He tells us in Ephesians 4:15, he says, speak the truth in love. That you may grow up in all things into him who is the head, Christ. Speak the truth in love. Yeah, you know, speaking the truth is important. But you got to speak the truth in love. You know, you're not doing it because you're trying to hurt. As a matter of fact, the most loving thing you can do is speak the truth. If you love somebody, you want to, you know, you warn them about the direction that they're heading in and that there's a way to be forgiven and you don't have to have the wrath of God be poured upon your life if you would just submit to him and surrender to him. I mean, how loving is that? All of us know that. You have a 2-year-old and they're playing in the yard. You tell them, don't go in the street. Why? Because I want to restrict you. No, because you don't want them to die. You love them. And because you love them, you warn them. Because you love them, you put boundaries around them. Because I love, I speak truth. And that truth may hurt. But if it's done in love, then, you know, at least there's that opportunity to hear a voice that's dissenting from what everybody else is saying. And he tells her, look, speak the truth in love. Jesus says, look, even when your enemies come after you, you're to love them. Matthew 5:44, I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you. Love. We're to love our enemies. We're to be praying for our enemies. That is, you know, the weapon of choice as a Christian. It's what's going to draw others to him. It's if we're displaying love. Romans 4:24 says this: "Or you despise the riches and the goodness and forbearance or long-suffering, not knowing that it's the goodness of God that leads a person to repentance." It's the goodness of God. So it's not to start an argument. It's not because we're wanting to start a fight. It's because, man, I love you. And I want you to know God loves you and God's good. And love is really the mark of Christianity. You realize that nowhere in the Bible this is they will know you're a Christian because you speak in tongues? It doesn't say that. It doesn't say they'll know you're a Christian because you did miracles. You know what it says? "By this all will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another." John 13:35. The mark of Christianity, Jesus says, the way that people will know you're a disciple is by the love that you have for one another. And that really is the heart of Christianity. Paul, from that point, verse 15, he's given us a couple of closing thoughts. It's there in verse 15. He says, "I urge you, brethren, you know the household of Stephanas, that it is the first fruits of Achaia, that they have devoted themselves to the ministry of the saints, that you also submit to such and to everyone who works and labors with us." Remember at the beginning when we began, it was in 1 Corinthians 1:10. He says, look, you need to be of one mind, one judgment. And he's saying, look, there's some leaders amongst you that have your best interests at heart. And Stephanas is one of those leaders. He says, look, he's there ministering to the saints. Submit to him. He's doing the work of the Lord. And if he's doing the work of the Lord, then you should come bring yourself under that so that you're now all of one mind and one heart. That's the only way the church will ever have an impact is if we're single-minded, we're one-hearted. We're all in agreement, man. That's what God says, and we're going to charge with what God says. But it also takes leadership. And he's saying, look, this guy's there to serve the church. He's there to help the church. And you guys need to, show him the respect and the honor. He says he's laboring among you guys. So it's a great task. And the way Paul describes it is that, it's something that deserved their respect. I like what Barclay wrote on that particular passage. He says, Stephanas deserved respect because he had put himself at the service of the church. And the early church willing and spontaneous service was the beginning of official office. A man became a leader of the church, not so much by man-made appointment as by the fact that his life and his work marked him out as one whom all men respect. T.C. Edwards says, in the church, many work, but few sweat. And that was a great, great perspective. A lot of workers, but how many people are really going to sweat when it comes to their laboring for the souls of men and for the body of Christ? And he says, look, this guy is doing that. He says, look at verse 17. I'm glad about the coming of Stephanas for Tenutus and Achaicus, for what was lacking on your part, they supplied, for they refreshed my spirit and yours, therefore acknowledge such men. And he was just encouraging them, look, these guys are laboring for the kingdom, man. Acknowledge that and have some respect for that. And then verse 19, as we conclude the book, he says, the churches of Asia greet you. Aquila and Priscilla greet you heartily in the Lord with the church that is in their house. Now, Aquila and Priscilla, we've kind of, been introduced to them in the book of Acts, and this was a couple. This is a couple that labored together for the kingdom. It's always awesome when you see, a husband and a wife that have that perspective. They're laboring together for the kingdom of heaven. When single-minded husband and wife are there saying, look, our lives are to be lived for the kingdom, for the things that are eternal. And they're, inside their house, they had a church that they were pastoring, that he was pastoring, and his wife with them. And they were, and he said, look, you guys are working.
Aquila and Priscilla, you know, they greeting you as well. These guys, you know, have the heart of God, and we see them over and over in the scriptures. And then he says, look, in verse 20, all the brethren greet you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. Now, it's interesting that, you know, you're kind of like, what is he talking about, greeting another with a holy kiss? That's weird. Now, you know, every culture has a little bit of different. When we travel to Peru, or we travel to, you know, South America, especially anywhere in South America, and, you know, whenever you go up and you talk to, you know, somebody, you greet somebody, they come and they kiss you on the cheek. And I remember the first time, you're kind of weird. You're like, they're going in. Like, what's going on? It's kind of weird, you know. And then they kiss you on one cheek, and then they go and they kiss you on the other cheek. And it's kind of like a double. And, you know, you just kind of like, okay, you know, remember the first night kissing the cheek, and you kind of pull away, and then they're kind of coming in again. You're like, whoa, what's up? And then, you know, you kind of go like, okay, that's normal. That's custom here. Everyone kisses each other on the cheek. I remember going to one country. I can't remember which one it was. They kissed you three times. It was, you know, left, right, left, I think. You know, just kind of, you know, and you got to get used to it. Like, that's a whole different kiss. I mean, what are you guys doing? Messing me up. Right? But here's the heart of it, guys. Here's what Paul's saying. He says, look, you guys are family. You guys are brethren. We're locked in together. There should be a great joy to be around other Christians, around other people who have the same faith, the same belief, willing to lay down their life just like you're willing to lay down your life for the things that are eternal. And there should be that kind of camaraderie, that kind of love for one another. And it's not so much a holy kiss, but man, you know, a hug, a handshake. It's like, man, it's so good to see you. Because we have something in common. We have the same Savior and the same Lord. And someday we're going to be together in heaven forever and ever and ever. And there should be that kind of awareness amongst one another. You know, and I love that Paul encourages that, greet one another with a holy kiss. And then he uses the next word, verse 22. He says, if anyone does not love, I skipped verse 21, that was it. The salutation with my own hand, Paul's. Now, all of the rest of this letter had been dictated by one of Paul's, you know, soldiers that were with him, one of the other fellow servants that were with him. And now Paul at the end of this, he goes, you know, I'm going to put my last words in with my own hand. It was believed that Paul was going blind, if not, you know, almost blind already, And Paul is writing this. So, you know, when he was going to write, it was going to be in big letters. And Paul goes, okay, I'm going to kind of write in my last few things. Now, can you imagine having a copy of that letter? How much you can get on eBay for that? I mean, that's a significant thing. Paul's going, I'm gonna close this thing out. And then he says there in verse 22, if anyone does not love the Lord Jesus Christ, let him be accursed. And then you're like, wait, why is Paul cursing? I mean, you know, people, I don't get it. That's really not what's being declared here. I like how the NLT says it. It says, if anyone does not love the Lord, that person is cursed. And I think here's what Paul's saying. Look, he just stating the fact that if someone doesn't have Jesus Christ in their life, that person is going to experience the wrath of God that's going to come upon all the world that's rejected the grace and the forgiveness that God's offered everyone. God's offered you forgiveness. You reject that forgiveness, there's no hope for you. It's the one thing that's able to deliver you from the consequence of sin. And he says, look, anyone who does not love the Lord Jesus, let him be accursed. And what he's stating is that person has chosen for his life the rejection of God. And therefore, he's going to get the consequence that's due that person. And so he just very, very, and then I love this, oh Lord, come. That's the word Maranatha. You ever heard that word Maranatha? Maranatha means come, Lord Jesus. That's the word that's literally used here. Come, Lord Jesus. And it should be the longing of every Christian. You know, Lord, you know, today would be great. I don't know about you. I just sometimes you wake up in the morning, it's like, Lord, let it be today. You ever, you know, Maranatha, And it's just kind of this expectation that today could be the day, you know, the Lord's going to come. Can I share it? Say this, Christian. If you don't have that desire, then I would ask, really, what is your priority? If you're not excited about the Lord Jesus coming back, did you realize what heaven's going to be like? No more pain, no more sorrow, no more tears, no more sin. We're going to be, and there's not going to be a need for a sun because the light is going to be Jesus himself. He's going to be the light. Now, if there's something here better than that, please tell me. I can't find it. I've been looking. There's nothing here. Not one more day do I want to be here that I can be in heaven. It's like a wasted day. And his encouragement is, look, man, my prayer is Jesus, come back. And it should be all our prayer. Jesus, come back. I long for the day. I think Paul's, you know, longing for the day. And then he says, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. The word grace, and I know most of you aware of that, what that word means. It means unmerited favor. Something you didn't deserve, but God offered you anyway. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. And that was his closing. He says, my love be with you all in Christ Jesus. Amen. And may the love of Jesus Christ and the grace of Jesus Christ be on our lives.